last two games, this guy is going to be a big-time running back. Summers takes it inside the 45 to the 44. It'll bring up a third down and still almost 5 yards to go.
Now, Gary, I have an inside source at South Carolina, my expert scouting service, Alex Hawkins, my old teammate, great football player at South Carolina, a great buddy of mine. He said the South Carolina defense is just getting stouter and stouter, and we just saw evidence that the old Hawk still knows a little something about football.
Or as Johnny Unitas used to call him, Whitey.
Well, he got called a lot of things.
Eric Bacon's on the move on a third down, getting rid of it deep. Overthrows his intended receiver inside the 10, and that's the ever-dangerous Troy Williamson, who may be as fast as anybody in college football.
Yeah, Williamson was open for just a moment or two down the sideline, but a great job by Roman Harper. Now, he's going to be working one-on-one against Ramsey Robinson, but watch Roman Harper over the top. Roman Harper knows that this guy is the most exciting young wide receiver in the SEC, and he kept great depth in the secondary.
I tell you, the guy just runs by people. So after the turnover, the Gamecocks not able to do much with it. Josh Brown back to punt, hit it very high. Drifting over is going to be Brandon Brooks. He's going to let it hit, and they're going to down it inside the 5-yard line. Beautifully done that time. It was down by Tremaine Tyler. Alabama will have the ball. No score, Alabama, South Carolina. Here's Alex Flanagan visiting with a guy who can't play football. We'll wait until after this first snap. As we mentioned, Gillen getting the starting call. And, you know, you hate to get a starting call because somebody else is hurt. But Alex will have that story in just a moment. From the 4 after a well-placed punt, here is Hudson trying to bounce outside, and his footing goes down. He got nothing. And now, Alex, take it away.
All right, Gary. Well, Brody, you tore your ACL against Western Carolina. Coach Shuler received a little bit of criticism for leaving you in, even though the team was up 31-0. What do you think?
No. You know, we hadn't done that great against them anyway, and, you know, I need to go back in there and have another series, and, you know, our first team offense did. It has nothing to do with his call. It's just a fluke thing that happens in football all the time.
When it happened, what was going through your mind?
I knew it as soon as I'd done it. You know, I did it in high school, and, you know, the first thing I told them was, you know, when they came out there, I was like, I tore it. He was like, it's gone. But, you know, you go through the mad stage, but, you know, once you get over that, you know, you just have to deal with it and move on.
Mark is getting only his second start of his career. How have you helped him?
You know, I'm just, you know, when I was making my first starts, you know, I didn't want anybody in here telling me what to do and, you know, bossing me around. So I've just been here for him. You know, if he wants to ask me a question or anything, you know, I'm here for him. But Mark's a good guy, and, you know, we've been friends ever since he got here. So, you know, Mark's going to be fine, and, you know, our football team's going to be fine.
All right, Brody. Well, we wish you a speedy recovery.
I appreciate it.
Gary, back to you.
You know the family real well, don't you, Bill?
Yes, John Croyle is a wonderful man. John Croyle's ranch for youth is one of the best things anywhere, particularly in this state. People appreciate him. He was an All-American player, a defensive end for Coach Bryant. There's Big John right there, agonizing with his son yet again, but loyal to his university. What the interception by Coach Simpson did, getting back to the football game, it obviously drastically changed field position. And Lou Holtz is over there licking his lips. The South Carolina defense right now, David, needs to get them stopped and make them punt out of the back of the end zone.
Well, they've done an unbelievable job this year. I mean, giving up less than 10 points a game. And they've played some tough opposition. I mean, they went on the road, played Vanderbilt, and they played obviously a very tough team in Georgia.
Well, and you think about it, they were out in front of that Georgia team, 16-0.
16-0, yeah.
Well, we had a timeout while Alex was visiting with Brody, and so the Tide now ready to go on a second down. Let's make it 9 yards to go for the 5. Tyrone Prothro comes in motion, and the throw comes on near side, and it's dropped, and they had some yardage on that play. LaRon McLean, the fullback, had some running room had he held on.
Listen, this guy, Mark Gillen's going to struggle. He's learning to play football in the Southeastern Conference. He needs his teammates desperately to make plays. My thing right here, I would have had Castile in the game at fullback, number 19. He catches everything.
Well, that was a beautiful ball from Mark Gillen. With the exception of the interception, I think he's spinning it pretty well here early in the football game.
McLean, a 258-pound sophomore, caught only two passes.
You mentioned Castile.
He is so versatile. Of course, his daddy, the All-America here at Alabama, they use him both with a tailback and a fullback. Third down and 9. And they're going to try to get some breathing room as they pound it forward. Ray Hudson, but that's going to be short of the first down. It'll bring up a fourth down. So Mike Shula's team trying to recover from the interception. The guy who beat Lou Holtz when he was a quarterback at Alabama. The only time Alabama has ever beaten Notre Dame. And that was quite a victory at that time.
That's right. And Mike was an outstanding quarterback here, and he was an outstanding scholar. When we got here, our coaching staff in 1987, he had just graduated. He was collecting honors right and left.
Noah Whiteside will go back for this punt from Bo Freeland. Here is Whiteside, exciting sophomore, waiting, makes a fair catch inside the 45-yard line. That's a nice punt, 47 yards. And so USC's got it. We have no score. I don't know about you guys, but that's a surprise to me.
Field day for Green to his big wide receivers, Gibson and Brown.
Second down and 4 now for South Carolina. It's going to be Summers again as a dose of Summers inside the 10, very close to the first and goal. Wallace Gilberry over to make the stop for Alabama.
South Carolina's best offensive lineman is Nashawn Goddard, number 70, the right tackle. He's just getting terrific movement. He's just knocking people off the ball, and that's where Summers is running, right over here. Watch the big guy. Boom, right in the middle of D'Amico Ryans and just still driving him.
Summers, a 205-pounder. He was an SEC all-freshman team pick a year ago. Sean Goddard, and Lou Holtz said he was playing the best of any in the offensive line coming into the game. Third down and a yard. And this time, Summers is going to be thrown for a loss. Beautiful play by Waldrop, the small linebacker. Now, I mean small. He doesn't weigh a lot, but he got back there and made the play to Marcus Waldrop.
Now, Lou Holtz earlier this week said, hey, we need to get positive yardage running the football. And when we don't make yards, we've got to eliminate the negative plays. Third and short, Holtz has him where he wants him, but Waldrop, tremendous penetration into the backfield, stones the running back.
Joe Kines, defensive coordinator for Alabama, said, Waldrop, well, he's a midget, but he just makes plays.
Mike Crowfoot to snap the ball. Josh Brown, who this year is 4 of 6 at a career-long 40-yarder against Troy, and his kick is up, and South Carolina has taken a 3-0 lead. Tonight on ESPN, it's a battle between two of the three remaining undefeated teams of the SEC as Cadillac Williams and the 9th-ranked Auburn Tigers take on Philip Fulmer and the 8th-ranked Tennessee Volunteers. College football primetime Saturday, also on ESPN at 7:45 Eastern. For more information, log into ESPN.com. You know, these guys have been talking on and on about Eric Ainge of Tennessee.
You look at those two quarterback systems, and
well, one of us has been talking about him. Go ahead, David.
Schaefer is a great
Pardon
quarterback.
Pardon me for interrupting you talking about Eric Ainge, your favorite subject.
Well, Schaefer is a great quarterback in his own right, and everybody knows about that Tennessee duo, and they've been getting great time, splitting time down at Tennessee. But I will tell you one thing, Bill. I think that Eric Ainge is going to be the number one pick in the draft, and we've only seen him 3 or 4 games so far, but I have not seen a kid that talented as a true freshman quarterback since John Elway played back in the late 70s.
Well, come on, David. Make a prediction. The guy's 14 years old, and we just saw Pinkins going to the locker room, so we'll let you know on that as soon as we learn what his problem is. But how old is Ainge? Is he 16?
He's just out of the lunch line.
Hey, I know his uncle really well, Danny Ainge.
Danny's
he has the same
shabby.
Kind of moxie, you know
yeah.
that?
You know what his statistics are this year? 36 for 56 with 8 touchdown passes.
Well, do y'all have a fan club?
He is from Oregon.
Bowers is kicking off, and going back will be Tyrone Brothers. He's going to bring it up to the 15, to the 20, the 25, to the 31-yard line. And that's where Bama will have it, down 3-0 after that 29-yard field goal. And You know, guys, you said it well. That interception really changed the complexion of this game.
Changed field position, but what's got to be more disturbing for Alabama, David, is that the way the South Carolina offensive line is just getting a surge, and LeSean Goddard especially is just knocking them back.
The Gamecocks are doing a great job on first and second down, but they've had some third and short situations, and they haven't been able to convert. True. And Alabama's defense has done a good job in third and short getting the ball and getting that Gamecock offense off the field.
So Mike Shula's team down by a field goal. We'll start from the 30-yard line. Gillen back to throw. He's got good protection. Going deep. Keith Brown. He's there. Can't get to it. Just overthrown at the 25-yard line.
That was a beautiful throw, and Brown did not keep his deep speed. Brown is going to reach out and not run through this football. This is a perfectly thrown ball. Watch Keith Brown, fastest receiver on the Alabama roster. And I'll tell you what, I didn't think he kept good deep speed once he got into the secondary, Bill.
There is a skill. You just continue to run full speed. You don't put your hands up until the last moment. And the great ones don't even have to be trained.
I tell you, Gillen needs some support. He's had a couple
Somebody's
of balls that should have been caught here tonight.
That's right.
Here is Gillen back to throw, and a short hitch. He completes it. He gets it over to Castile. Castile's forward progress will be marked at the 37-yard line. Coe Simpson, who made the interception earlier with the tackle.
Well, I love Castile as a football player because he does everything well. He's a terrific blocker. He runs well from fullback or from the tailback position. He catches everything. He's the kind of reliable player that's going to have to assist Mark Gillen. He really needs his guys to step up for him.
And so it's going to bring up now third down, still three. They have three wideouts on the set. They move the tight end, Clint Johnston. Gillen on the play action. Over the middle, a screen, complete to Hudson, and it's going to be close. Did he get the first down? There is a flag on the play. A flag on the play. Ricardo Hurley, one of the most heavily recruited linebackers coming out of high school there to make the tackle.
It's going to be Kyle Tatum holding number 58, the right tackle on Marcus Lawrence. Just had a little takedown there. There's a temptation when you're a big guy. You want to get that linebacker out of the way.
Holding offense, number 58. The penalty's 10 yards. In the run, repeat, third down.
They had a first down at this state.
And watch Tatum, the big right tackle.
It just went out of the picture. He is there. Yeah, you see the residual effect of the takedown. You just can't do that, Mr. Tatum.
He didn't need the takedown. He had his back had the first down, and I have been really impressed with Gillen early in this football game. He is throwing the ball very athletically. Every ball has been on the money, with the exception of the interception.
We understand that Pinkins had an equipment issue. He's not hurt. There's a bad snap to Gillen. He's going to have to fall on a third down and 13. They don't even get a shot at it. So they're going to have to punt the football away.
Here's the thing about a gun snap. It has to tumble back, and it should not be rocketed back. It should be at the belt level. This goes up shoulder pad height. The quarterback has a very difficult time to catch that football when it's snapped that hard. When you're accustomed to having it tumbled waist high and it's suddenly rocketed, that's on J.B. Klausner. He's got to do a better job. And again, this guy, Gillen, needs a little help from his friends.
Yeah, he's not getting the support he needs, and this is first start at home, and there's the punt by Freeland. Noah Whiteside's going to let this ball hit, go sideways, takes the South Carolina bounce to the 47-yard line. So good field position for the Gamecocks as they have a 3-0 lead. That was only a 31-yard punt.
South Carolina leads Alabama by 3 points. We talk about Alabama quarterback Mark Gillen needing a little help from his offensive line on the field. Well, off the field, he's got a lot of support from his roommates. Gillen lives with Wesley Britt, Kyle Tatum, and they help him out in a big house, a six-bedroom house, a little bit off of campus. It has a jacuzzi in the backyard. Youngest Britt brother, Justin, lives in the dorm. He has a room in the house, as does former Bama player Justin Smiley, also Taylor Britt, one of the roommates there too. David, you know, you guys up in the booth know that having the help of the offensive line means a lot.
Yeah, and you're jealous, Alex. It was as neat as a pin, which is hard for me to believe. Back to throw now is Newton going deep. The ball at the 5 and broken up. That was a near miss to Williamson. And there's a flag. Ramsey Robinson may be called for interference on the play.
He definitely interfered. And when he did that, he prevented a touchdown. It would have been a touchdown. It was a beautiful throw. It was a great job by Lou Holtz and his play calling to come out here and go for a big one. I felt like South Carolina needed something big to happen early in the game. Well, they did it. But I would, here's
pass interference against the defense. Number 17. The penalty's 15 yards from the previous spot. First down.
Now, this is the second time that they've sent Troy Williamson on a streak down the field. Ball was just slightly underthrown, and you've got to get your football, your eyes back to the football, number one, and you can't make that type of contact on a featured receiver. Easy call for the officiating crew.
What did the quarterbacks tell us? They say they have to lead this guy so far. Williamson will just run the ball down.
The other thing is I wouldn't leave anybody in single coverage on him in this game because he's the main threat.
So the penalty gets him the first down outside the 30-yard line, and here is Summers going airborne, and he is knocked down. Terrific play that time by the middle linebacker, Freddie Roach. Let's go to Matt Weiner in the studio.
Gary, Purdue absolutely put the hammer to Notre Dame in South Bend. Kyle Orton to Taylor Stubblefield, and you were watching the longest play from scrimmage against Notre Dame in Irish football history, 97 yards. Orton had four more touchdowns, 41-16.
I'm going to tell you, that Purdue football team's pretty good, aren't they?
Kyle Orton's
pretty good. They are really good. They're good on defense.
Second down now, virtually 10 yards to go. Three wideouts, trips formation, top of the field. Here is Newton setting up a screen, trying to get to Summers. That was ill-conceived. In fact, Anthony Madison, a senior out of Thomasville, Alabama, was nearest to the football.
Bill, Newton has a nice throwing arm, and he can really attack the field down the field, but he's had trouble throwing screen passes early in the season.
He throws the deep ball reasonably well. He throws the intermediate routes well, but you're right, he struggled with the screen, but he reminds me, I think he has the potential to be another Seneca Wallace, the great quarterback at Iowa State a couple of years ago.
In his first start, he threw for 324 yards against South Florida when Pinkins was hurt. Here we go, third down. And Alabama may be offside. The flag is out, and they're going to blow the play dead. They were coming on the blitz, Chris Harris, and he just didn't get back in time.
Not a good feeling if you're an Alabama person right now. Too many mistakes on both sides of the ball, dropped balls. Not much help for the quarterback in the running game.
Offsides, defense, contact. Penalty 5 yards, repeat, third down.
And Chris Harris, the right defensive end, as we look again, watch Pinkins coming back out.
That was an equipment thing, David, with Pinkins, we've been told. There was no injuries. He comes back on the field. So the penalty now is going to make it a third down and five. Pinkins, the senior, who does such a good job of changing the plays, a big leader, now being replaced by Newton, trying to build the South Carolina lead. And he's going to go straight up the middle. And Newton gets inside the 25 to about the 23. It's going to be fourth down. That's Roach again, the middle linebacker.
Wow, he had such a hole open out to the right. Uh-oh, we got a few little fisticuffs down there.
Looks like Robinson and Matthew Thomas. Thomas, the wide receiver for South Carolina.
Well, I told you it wouldn't be a friendly place out on that field, but the little fellas don't need to be cockfighting out there. Let the big guys do all the slugging and kicking. You little guys, just go out there and put your hands on your hips and run your routes.
Well, those fights on the outside have been a big story early in the SEC season. That Florida-Tennessee game, the defensive back and the wide receiver tangled up late.
Unsportsmanlike. 15. Red, 17, white.
He's got a reverse, but he's right.
Penalty, offset, fourth down.
Ironically, Bill, that should have been the call in that Tennessee-Florida
Why
game
did
right
I
there.
Know you were going to say that? How did I know that?
I've been hanging around you guys too much. Scares me a little bit. I'm starting to think like you. But anyway, it's on both guys. He had Thomas. Thomas was the white and Robinson the red. So this play will be now fourth down and two. And here they come. Double tight ends. Newton on the pitch to Boyd. And That may be a first down saving tackle. Great reaction that time by Roman Harper, who came over and cut the legs out from under him. What a play.
Football is a game of angles and leverage. Roman Harper is a marvelous free safety. Having moved from strong safety, he's a good tackler. He understands speed and angles, and he got just the right one for Corey Boyd and managed to get him on the ground.
That is one of the best tackles from the free safety position in a big situation that you'll see all year. It looked like Boyd might have been able to score on that play. What a play by Harper.
Harper, their leading tackler out of Prattville, Alabama, and he is the leader back there. He's like a coach on the field. What a play. So Alabama takes over. They'll have the ball inside their own 25 and end around reverse, given to Brown. Brown trying to get wide. He's got the corner. 35, 40. You see the speed of this true freshman out of Florida. That's a 17-yard burst on the play.
Well, and the story of this game early is the Alabama defense giving up yards on first and second down, but making big plays on third and short and fourth and short. And they've done a great job of hanging in this football game, keeping Alabama in the game.
I tell you, this Brown is going to be something special. He's been nicked up a little bit. He is out of Fort Walton Beach, Pensacola High School, and he just went 17 yards on sheer speed. First down now, just across the 40. Gillen on the play action. He's going to dump it up. It's Kenneth Darby. Darby gets to the 44 and he's knocked down. Darby alternating in that tailback spot with Ray Hudson. It was Marcus Lawrence, the middle linebacker, there to make the stop. And we have another penalty. The flag at the 40.
Well, Evan Mathis, number 51, blindsided Darryl Shropshire, and it was very close. It looked like he hit him from the side. We'll take a look in the replay. That seems to be the call by the official, but we'll wait and let him tell us.
Mathis, the senior out of Homewood, Alabama, one of the leaders up front, playing alongside Wesley Britt. So they'll sort it out. Shropshire giving him the option for South
Walking
Carolina.
Back against the offense, number 74, feeling 10 yards from the spot of the pile. Repeat, first down.
It was not Mathis. So the block Mathis made was legal. The one I saw, apparently J.B. Klausner hit somebody from the rear. I didn't see that.
Shropshire, the guy who's playing with a wrapped hand. I tell you what, Alabama's been their own worst enemy in this football game thus far. They're down 3-0. They have the ball at the 30-yard line. It'll be first and 20. Mike Shula. From the great family of Don Shula, he said that dad told him just to be himself and then work hard and believe in what you're doing. On the first and 20. Gillen up the field. The catch is made inside the 40. Coming back to the ball is another freshman, DJ Hall. And that's going to bring us to the end of the first quarter. David Norrie, Bill Curry, Gary Bender, Alex Flanagan. We start the second quarter here from Bryant-Denny Stadium on the campus of the University of Alabama. Second and 12 for the Tide. Down 3-0. And the handoff comes to Hudson trying to bounce outside, protecting the ball. Marcus Lawrence already this fifth tack over there to make the stop. It'll bring up a second down, or third down.
If there's a bright spot early in this football game for Alabama outside of their third down defense, it's really Mark Gillen. He is throwing the ball exceptionally well as a quarterback. He's 5-for-8, had a drop from his fullback earlier in the first quarter, but I think he has come into this football game and thrown the ball right on the money.
Well, I guess if another quarterback analyzes it that way, coach, we got to go along with it. Third down now, seven yards to go.
I agree.
Four wideouts on this play for Gillen. Gillen stepping up, takes a shot. The ball knocked out at the 50 as they could not make the connection that time. Great pressure coming up the middle. That was Orris Lambert who was in his face that time. Ezekiel Knight, a freshman, tried to make the catch, but he was jarred loose for the ball.
Number 51, Orris Lambert, right in his face. But once again, David, the throw was right where you want it. Right between the 8 and the 4.
That was a huge hit. And Gillen took the hit right on the delivery. You're right, Bill. He still delivered the ball.
So a 3-1 back to punt. Noah Whiteside goes back for Carolina. Beautiful punt. He's going to have to call for the fair catch. Backs and makes it at the 10. And so now the Gamecocks with a 3-0 lead after that 46-yard punt. And here's our Yamaha game track. The interception by Cole Simpson. He returned at 35 yards and gave the Gamecocks a field position. Then Demetrius Summers, who's been out the last two games, a burst up the middle for 38 yards. And the 29-yard field goal by Josh Brown. And that's where we stand right now at the 14-minute mark of the second quarter.
One thing South Carolina has not exploited, in my opinion, is to attack Charlie Pepper. He's a corner that moved to safety. He's going to be a very good, strong safety, but he's still learning. He has a little trouble on the perimeter, number 26. Let's look and see if they exploit him a little bit. The other thing's play action against Harper.
So still under quarterback is Newton, trying to scramble around, and he finds some time. I don't know, that play didn't look good at all as he got out to about the 10-yard line.
It did look like a broken play in the backfield, and you know, early in this football game, it's very much vintage Lou Holtz. Not a lot has happened score-wise. We have a 3-0 score, but turnovers, field position, taking care of the football. Lou Holtz has done all the little things with his football team, and it is just Lou Holtz personified the way his team has come out and played early in this football game.
I think it's kind of scarier if it's Alabama. They haven't really thrown the ball, have no yards, and you know Williamson is lurking. Here now is the fullback, Boyd, who makes the catch, and he makes it to about the 14-yard line, and here's Matt Weiner.
Hi, Gary. The highest-rated quarterback in the nation when the weekend began is Cal's Aaron Rodgers, and he's at it again. Three touchdown passes today, including this one to Chris Mandarino, and the Bears up 35-7. Start of the fourth.
Well, I tell you, Cal has been idle for a couple of weeks. And Aaron Rodgers, have you seen him play, David?
Absolutely.
Oh, he is something special. Saw him earlier against Air Force. Five DBs now for the Tide on a third down and five. Newton is back, scrambling, trying to get the first down running. Now dumps it to the near side, up and into the Alabama bench. Great pressure that time. Waldrop, who earlier made a big play. And there is a flag.
One of Coach Holtz's complaints with Newton last week was that he didn't know when to get rid of the ball. He ran around too much and didn't make things happen, and then didn't unload the ball and just took sacks. So obviously some coaching has been done in that
Holding
context.
Offense, number 60. Phillies decline to fourth down.
Problems up front with the offensive guards for South Carolina. That was Chris White. The penalties declined, but the guards are struggling in the Carolina offensive scheme.
Both of these offenses are going to struggle some tonight. South Carolina comes into the game giving up 9 points per contest. Alabama only gives up 250 yards per game in total defense.
This is Josh Brown, who'll putt away to the ever-dangerous Brandon Brooks. Brooks backpedaling inside the 40s, got it at the 37, tries to go wide, breaks his tackle, and fights forward. Great effort, but he's still going to be stopped inside the 35. And a 40-yard punt, a minus-5 return, and Bear Bryant's shadow is everywhere in Tuscaloosa. And since the Bear, which coach has the highest winning percentage, we'll tell you when we come back.
Gary Hollingsworth, and then to have Homer Smith and Don Lindsay on the coaching staff, along with a lot of other great coaches, it was a wonderful opportunity.
Bill, I have a question. Was that your PR guy or your agent that fit that in there for you?
Here's Hudson. Hudson. Very close to the first down as he goes across the 40 to the 41 now. You guys have both saw Homer Smith. You went to eat with him last night. He came up to see you today.
He did such a marvelous job here and everywhere that he coached. And when you get these guys in the crimson shirts on the field, they are so motivated. They want so much to win that all you got to do is turn them loose and have them properly coached up, and you'll win.
Homer was my offensive coordinator and quarterback coach for 5 years, and really the five best years that Terry Donahue had out at UCLA.
So it's going to be second and a yard to go for the Tide after that 9-yard burst. This time the give goes to Castile. He bursts out of there. He's to the 40, to the 30, the 25, and down at the 20-yard line. Cole Simpson, Tremaine Tyler caught up with him, and Tim Castile, the sophomore from Birmingham, just took it 39 yards.
This was so beautifully blocked. That right side of the Alabama offensive line, and the big guys are starting to take a toll now. Boom! Look at the smash in the hole coming up in there. Couldn't see who it was, but it was a marvelous block. Probably that was Clint Johnston, number 88, a tight end, pulling around up inside on the inside backer, Laurie. What a nice job.
So Alabama now resides at the South Carolina 20-yard line. 11 minutes to go here in the second quarter. Hand to Hudson. Hudson going straight ahead. Boy, he runs tough. 170 yards last week, averaging almost 8 yards a carry. George Goss on the stop.
Mike Shula has such a great luxury in being able to be versatile at the running back position. You got Ray Hudson, really a home run threat back every time he touches a football. But on that prior play, when Castile broke it down the field, they line up with two fullbacks, McLean and Castile, and they really give you a different look.
Here they are again. I wouldn't have a third and three or less without these two guys in the game, I'll tell you.
Double tight ends, David Cavan and Clint Johnston in now for the Tide. Gilliam, the play action, stepping up, throwing end zone, and nobody's there, almost picked off. That was a near interception by Fred Bennett, the cornerback for South Carolina.
Gillen was looking for Clint Johnston again, and Clint Johnston broke off his route. He was running a corner route, and Gillen has to feel this and just throw it away. He keeps this ball in play and just gets the football back. He almost got a pick there in the end zone. As a quarterback, when you feel that tight end breaking off his route, just get rid of the football out of the back of the end zone.
Fred Bennett had an interception last game against Troy. Third down now, 7. Trying to capitalize on this 39-yard run earlier by Castile. It's Hudson with the ball. Hudson not going to get the first down, as Rodriguez Wilson, the senior out of Cross, South Carolina, was there to stop him.
We visited with Hudson yesterday, and he talked about this South Carolina defense and how hard they came downfield on you from the linebacker positions. They really come up and play the run, Bill.
They've done a wonderful job, and they've contained him for the most part. He popped one 10 or 12 yard run and that's it, but he looks like he's going to go the distance every time he touches it.
It's a 29 yard field goal attempt. Brian Bostic, who was 4 of 4, he's made all 22 kicks, field goals and PATs. Out of the hold of Alec Fox, the kick is on the way, and we have a tie game. Both teams now with 29-yard field goals. We're deadlocked. Atkin quarter, both teams with 29-yard field goals. Kicking off, the guy who was at the prep school, the Naval Academy, Jamie Christensen out of Norcross, Georgia. He will kick off. Back deep is Matthew Thomas and Andre Goss, and we're back into action. Beautifully kicked. Thomas goes back, and I think he's going to go to a knee, and he does. Let's go down to Alex Fleming. Alex?
Well, Gary, not only do Savelle Newton and Dondrell Pinkins get along, they actually, Dondrell calls Savelle his little brother. He's his little brother through a program that Lou Holtz set up called the Big Brother Program. The big brother being Dondrell shows Savelle around campus and kind of takes care of him when he's a freshman, kind of answers questions for him and is just there for him. Now, of the rotating quarterback situation, Savelle says, hey, Dondrell is the senior. He says, I kind of liken it to going on a long road trip where you have a backup driver, and I'm the backup driver. Not a bad backup driver, Gary.
Well, I think you're right. Now they've gone back to Dondrell Pinkins, who started the game. He comes back in at quarterback at the 20-yard line, and he gives up, and this is going to be Summers. Summers shut down as now Alabama adjusting a little bit to him. Charlie Peppra, the strong safety, over to make the stop.
Charlie Peppra struggled with those very plays just like that a week ago against Arkansas, and this time he took a more intelligent angle. And what that means is Joe Kynes and his defensive staff have been coaching this strong safety position with Charlie. Did a nice job and got a good back on the ground in the open field.
Charlie moved over from the cornerback spot to play the strong safety spot. Double tight ends, 2nd and 9. Pinkins on the half roll. Up the field, tried to hit his tight end, Andy Boyd, and he really took a shot from Peppra. And let's go back to Matt White. We're tied at 3 now, Bill and David. What do you think Lou Holtz was saying in this discussion?
Well, I asked a friend who played for Woody Hayes one time, how would you describe Woody? He said, I would say he had an arresting personality. Dondrell's been arrested.
3rd down now and 9 after the timeout. Pinkins releases with a bullet to Matthew Thomas, and that gets him out of a big hole on a third and nine, a first down catch, a 17-yard pickup on the play.
Now, this is a nice job by Pinkins staying alive in the pocket. He doesn't have a lot downfield in the way of open receivers, but he's going to step up into the void in the pocket and then takes a huge hit on the release from Wallace Gilberry. That's just great poise to wait, step up into the pocket, and then find Thomas in a little seam over the middle.
Thomas had a 30-yard touchdown catch last week against Troy. So the 17-yard pickup sets it up first down at the 38. This time he's able to wedge it forward. Pinkins, a big 245-pounder.
Gary, I should add that one of Lou Holtz's first jobs was as a secondary coach for guess who? Woody Hayes. So he got this training honestly.
It didn't cost him anything extra, right?
He's not going to let things just sort of fester.
I liken playing quarterback to Lou Holtz to playing basketball for Bobby Knight. You know coming in that you're going to get coached hard.
Bob Knight was there at the same time. This friend of mine, Dick LeBeau, who's now defensive coordinator for the Steelers at Ohio State.
I think Bobby Knight's a lot more scary, though. Here's a pass complete to the fullback, and that is Corey Boyd. And Boyd gets some running room, and he's got a first down. Boyd got outside. 15-yard pickup. There is a penalty flag.
A couple penalty flags, and that might have been a late hit.
Nice job by number one, Noah Whiteside, a little fella, locking on a linebacker, DeMarcus Waldrop. Just got up in his numbers, and let's see what the flag is.
Dead ball, personal foul against the defense, number 41. Penalty's 15 yards from the end of the run, first down.
Well, that's Roman Harper, the leader in that secondary, with a late hit. There's Harper.
Usually Dondrell Pinkins is the quarterback that likes to run the football more, but his passing skills have gotten the South Carolina Gamecocks on the move. And Harper, I mean, if Harper holds off there, he's okay, but you don't throw the ball carrier to the ground 2 yards out of bounds. That's not a smart play by the all-SEC free safety.
Alabama has five penalties for 54 yards. South Carolina has not been penalized at all. First down now. 27-yard line of the Tide. Here is Pinkins on the option. He keeps it, and he's able to negotiate the 25-yard line. And be sure to join us tomorrow night for ESPN Sunday Night Football. Marshall Faulk and the high-powered Rams head to San Francisco to take on the 49ers. Their new quarterback, Ken Dorsey. Coverage begins with NFL Primetime, presented by Miller Lite at 7:30 Eastern. For more information, log on to ESPN.com. I'll tell you what, Marshall Faulk hasn't been getting the football very much, and he made a comment this week that they need to get it to him.
Well, I think I would hand it to Marshall as many times he wanted it.
Second down and eight now, and we have movement. We're going to have a penalty flag. A lot of laundry coming out, three flags, in fact.
That was Anthony Bryant, defensive tackle number 97. And the quarterbacks for South Carolina are doing a nice job with their cadence. That's the second time early in this football game that South Carolina quarterbacks have lured defensive linemen into the neutral zone.
Well, they spent all afternoon Thursday.
Dead ball, all sides, against the defense, number 97. We had contact. Penalty's 5 yards from the previous spot. Repeat, second down.
Defensive linemen lined up with their coaches. See there, Anthony's only squats 755. He's a strong young man, but they worked much of Thursday afternoon on watching the football and not responding to noise.
Keep in mind, the quarterbacks have been working from the shotgun some. They're going under center here, but they've been luring them into the neutral zone from the shotgun.
You know, Bryant can also dunk a basketball. Here's a handoff straight ahead, and they've got a first down as they just moved the pile forward that time. That was Summers. Boy, this Summers has really given them a new dimension. Terrence Jones, Justin Britt on the stop.
And when you have the threat of a quarterback running, plan plays for the quarterback to run, you pick up an extra blocker, and that's very tough on a defense. Lou Holtz doing a masterful job of running between the tackles early in this football game.
So the change to Pinkins has really jump-started this offense. They have a first down. They have the ball at the 17-yard line of Alabama, approaching 6 minutes to go in the first half. Double tight end to Lyman. Hand off to Summers. Nice cutback, and he lunges forward. Now, that wasn't a big gainer, but that was an impressive run by Summers as he gets the ball close to the 10-yard line. Pepra made the stop.
It was a nice run, but it was an even better block by Nashawn Goddard, number 70. He's going to pull from his right tackle spot and lead up in here. Summers is going to get in behind him. Look at number 70. Clears the hole. Using Roman Harper like he was a pinball.
There's Goddard out of Dayton, Ohio, a 305-pound, 6'6" right offensive tackle. Second and five. Looks like Pinkins is changing the play. Two receivers to Summers, and no place to go. Alabama responding very well, and especially Waldrop. We've called his name a lot. He's only a 200-pounder, a freshman, a redshirt. At the linebacker spot.
Conservative football by Lou Holtz. He's not only working away at the belly of that Alabama defense, pounding between the tackles, but Lou Holtz keeps his mind on the clock as well, and he likes to keep that defense on the sideline, likes to keep them rested with his conservative style of football.
So we have now a third down and four just outside the 10. Big play in this football game. White side is split to the near side. Five defensive backs for Alabama. From the shotgun, Pinkins setting up a screen. Boyd almost made a one-handed catch. That would have been a remarkable catch by Corey Boyd out of Orange, New Jersey. Freddie Roach, the linebacker, getting in the face of Pinkins.
Freddie Roach, as Joe Kines told us about this day before yesterday, Freddie Roach is lined up at left defensive end. He's coming off the left side of your screen, number 8. He's normally a middle linebacker. He beat Brian Brownlee, number 39, a tight end, trying to protect on him and force the errant throw.
And Boyd has shown an ability to make that catch early in the season. He's made a couple acrobatic catches early in the season for South Carolina. If Pinkins gives him a little bit better ball, he scores there.
He's made a 29-yarder. Josh Brown has. This is a 28-yarder for the lead. Out of the hold of Joey Bowers. The kick is up, and Carolina has the lead for the second time. 6-3. Well, this is quite a tradition. And as you would expect, we have had some outstanding hits. Well, it's a battle of field goals as Brown with his second field goal of the game. Josh Brown has now given Carolina another lead. And I guess if you're Mike Shula, you got to say, hey, we haven't played very well and we're only down by 3.
That's right. But the flip side of that, Gary, is you got Lou Holtz on the other sideline and you're letting them hang around. You should have scored more points. You've made a lot of mistakes, too many penalties. You let Lou Holtz hang around, you get beat.
And you just know that Lou Holtz loves a 6-3 game.
Yes, he does. This is his kind of deal.
Pro throw and Brooks go back for this kickoff from Joey Bowers. Takes a wicked hop, and they're going to set down on the knee and bring it out to the 20-yard line. Well, we mentioned Mike Shula, October 4th, 1986, Legion Field. Mike Shula hit split in Albert Bell for a 52-yard touchdown strike. And then, now the Alabama coach, the South ball, comes back and hits tight end Howard Cross for a touchdown. Alabama beats Notre Dame 28-10, Alabama's first win ever over Notre Dame. And, of course, Mike Shula would like now to win as a coach against Lou Holtz.
Well, in career against Alabama, Lou Holtz 2-3. And I remember Mike Shula. I started at UCLA in 85. The year before, Mike Shula, 9-2-1 with that team, and he led the country in passing efficiency for most of the season.
So Alabama will start for the 20. Gillen rolls out, and he hits his tight end. That's Clint Johnston. Johnston, a big, rugged guy who's played hurt so much, now healthy. The junior makes a 13-yard catch on the play.
Yeah, but he double-clutched it. He even made that up. He put the excitement back in the naked boot when the tight end double-clutches it. When are they going to just look one in and catch it normally?
They are.
Somebody other than Castile.
They are getting beat up by the football a little bit out there, but I still like the way Gillen's looking, and I think that the way to protect this young quarterback is to throw on some first and second downs, run situations.
First down now to 33, 3:52 left in this first half. Gillen on a delayed handoff. It's Darby. Darby to the 40 and shut down at the 41-yard line. Tonight on ESPN, it's a battle between two of the three remaining undefeated teams in the SEC. Carnell, Cadillac Williams, and the ninth-ranked Auburn Tigers take on Philip Fulmer and the eighth-ranked Tennessee Volunteers. What a game that should be. College football primetime Saturday on ESPN at 7:45 Eastern. Again, for more information, log on to ESPN.com. You can see the leading rushers in the SEC. Well, this conference does have a few running backs, don't they?
Better this year than ever.
And here's Darby on a second and two, and that's a first down and then some. He crosses the midfield stripe. Rodriguez Wilson over to make the stop. And you said this yesterday, Bill. When you start running Hudson and Darby at you, those guys start to wear down defensively.
That's what you want to do. You just want to grind down the defense, no matter who you're playing, but especially this South Carolina bunch that's been so gritty under Rick Minter, and they do have such a variety of weapons. Hudson's over here resting right now.
So Darby with that run picks up the first down just inside the South Carolina end of the field. They send McLean, the big pullback, in motion. They give to Darby. Darby bounces it to the 47, a gain of two. Darby, a sophomore out of Huntsville, Alabama, waited his chance to play. Sean Williams was the running back a year ago that got most of the work.
And then a lot of people say, hey, the way Hudson's running the football, Darby's made early in the season. Where was Hudson a year ago? And Hudson fumbled the ball some early in the season. It gave Sean Williams the opportunity to crack that number one slot at tailback, and the rest is history.
And Williams now with the Buffalo Bills. He signed as a free agent. Here's Gillen back, setting up, deep drop, near side, wide open, a catch is made, open field move this time by Hudson, and Hudson's got a first down. They have it at the 35, picked up 10 on the play.
Nice patience by Gillen to look down the field, come to his back as a secondary receiver, keep the chains moving.
Exactly, and his teammates are beginning to respond by making catches for him, and the big guys are starting to knock some holes. Now we see if Alabama can achieve offensive consistency for a drive.
I'm in at 43 now as they have a first down. It's Castile this time in motion for Gillen. Gillen with a nice play action, setting up, going deep. Ball up, Cadell. Matt Cadell, did he catch it in the field of play? No, he was out of bounds. Matt Cadell, a redshirt freshman, that was a near miss.
That was an out and up. That was a deep out, and it was designed for Cadell to turn it up. He runs the out, pump fake from Gillen, and then he turns it up the sideline. And as a quarterback, you've got to keep the football in bounds. If Gillen keeps him in bounds, that's a touchdown.
Stops the clock with 1:28. Brings up now second down 10 at the 36 of South Carolina. Alabama down by three. The steal again goes in motion. Gillen gives a Hudson trying to go wide. He's to the 30, the 25, he's to the 20, and fights his way down to the 16-yard line. First down, and let's go to Matt Weiner.
All right, Garrett, coming up at halftime, an SEC shocker in Athens as the BCS champions get bushwhacked between the hedges. A little revenge for the Hokies at Virginia Tech as they take care of the Big East best team, plus maybe the performance of the day from Purdue getting all over the Golden Dogs. All coming up at half.
Okay, that Virginia Tech team, they're a gritty team, aren't they? They are always tough to beat in Blacksburg.
Beamer ball.
Had USC on the ropes in that opener.
First down now, and a delayed handoff. The ball is fumbled by Hudson, but he got it back. Boy, I tell you, that was a dangerous play.
Well, it's a forward pass.
Yeah,
it went on the ground. It's just an incomplete pass.
It was a shuffle pass, and so it is an incomplete pass. But so all of a sudden now, the clock becoming a big issue here. 30 or 58 seconds left in the half, and it's going to be at the 17-yard line, second down 10.
Plenty of time, though. Second down and 10. You've got 58 seconds, two timeouts. If Gillen works the clock properly, has plenty of time for a touchdown with a field goal in his hip pocket.
He's going to give off to Hudson. Big stick that time. Oh, what a tackle by Dowdy. You don't hear a lot about this guy, but boy, did he make a big play there. That is Stanley Dowdy, a redshirt freshman.
Just looks like there was a bust by the offensive line. Yep, he was supposed to be secured by the right guard, Danny March, And he sent March simply slipped off and allowed him to come clean. And you don't want that guy hitting your back in the backfield. Like that, a lot of times the ball flies up in the air.
I'm out. Alabama.
Alabama now has one timeout left as they stop the clock with 32 seconds. And Dowdy is excited. Alabama down by three, had to use their second timeout. 32 seconds left in the half. Dowdy with a big defensive stop just a moment ago for South Carolina.
It was an extreme stunt. He lined up in a one technique inside the guard and leaped all the way to the outside shoulder. March left him, the right guard. He took part and went on up to the linebacker, and nobody else touched him.
Third and 12 after the play by Dowdy. Mark Gillen on the play action. Looking. Into the corner. Ball is there. Keith Brown can't hang on. He was out of bounds maybe anyway, and Brown's shaken up. This guy has been nicked. He is one of those guys who's an immense talent. You hope that's not a serious injury.
Well, Gillen had him in the end zone. Gillen's got to get that ball up just a split second sooner. That's the second time he's had a wide receiver open for a touchdown, doesn't get the ball up quick enough, and leads his wide receiver out of bounds. This is a post corner route. Ball's thrown well. Boy, that is dangerous how close that wall is down in the end zone.
Well, you look now, they're going to have to, with 25 seconds left, kick the field goal as we'll get an update on Keith Brown. We will not try to in any way guess as to the extent of the injury. But Brown, I don't think, even had he caught on, he went in the field of play. I think he was out of the end zone.
Oh, that is so dangerous. And there's a number of stadiums across the country where you have that wall close in the corner. I remember playing out at UCLA, the Rose Bowl, and the corners were even closer than here in Tuscaloosa. And that is a dangerous play.
So they're going to have to settle for the field goal to bring Bostic in to try to tie it up. You can see what David was talking about, how close the wall is and with the momentum. And Brown's a big guy, 6'3", and ran out of real estate in a hurry.
He was doing his best to get that foot in bounds and make the catch, and it's great effort in the corner for his quarterback.
And bear in mind, too, he's a true freshman, so this is all brand new to him. When you got a true freshman playing at this level with the finest athletes in the world in this sport, then everything is new. Every experience, every attempt to make your job, to get your job done, is brand new to you.
You see the players very concerned. They're going to bring in the cart. We're going to take a break. 25 seconds left in the half for Gillen and Alabama.
This is Marty Reid at Route 66 Raceway. We had to go off the air before we completed Funny Car qualifying, and we can tell you it is another record setter in the making, because John Force is number one qualifier, runs a 4.697 elapsed time, 332 miles an hour. No one's ever done it. There are the matchups. John Force, Tony Pedregon, Cruz Pedregon, and Gary Denjum have lane choice. There, you see the matchups on the other side. Our coverage tomorrow at Sunday at 8 Eastern, and at noon we'll show the run on NHRA Today.
Well, we have a delay right now, an anxious moment for everyone here, as Keith Brown, the freshman out of Fort Walton Beach, Florida, out of Pensacola High School, the true freshman, so gifted, tried to make that catch, and right now they're being very cautious with him. They're holding up play with 25 seconds left to go in this first half. Come back, Alabama will be attempting a field goal. Tonight on ESPN, it's a battle between two of the three remaining unbeaten teams, and I tell you what, all day long today, I heard about this Eric Ainge and the 6'6" quarterback. And so his Tennessee Volunteers will be playing host to Auburn. That's coming up at 7:45. And let's go back to Matt Weiner.
All right, we'll get you back to Tuscaloosa in just a moment when play resumes. In the meantime, let's get you caught up on what's going on around the SEC. A shocker in Athens, Georgia, between two of the powerhouses of the conference, BCS champs LSU, between the hedges to take on the Bulldogs. Many have questioned Georgia's offense, particularly in the red zone, where they've struggled to put touchdowns into the end zone. That was not a trouble for Mark Richt's team today. Second quarter, David Green to Fred Gibson, just getting started. 2-yard touchdown, 17-0 Dogs. Green looking for Reggie Brown this time. Nicely thrown ball, nice catch as well. Brown has a touchdown. Georgia up 24-0. Watch it again. Nifty grab from Brown over his shoulder, twisting as he caught it. Third quarter, Green to Gibson. Second time they hooked up. Georgia up 31-10. Green with a school record, 5 touchdown passes without an interception. He also ties the school record for career wins with 36. Reggie Brown, couple touchdown catches, and had Gibson and Georgia all over LSU. Arkansas and Florida, Florida Field. Gators Chris Leak would have a career day. Second quarter, Andre Caldwell, the double reverse. Caldwell slips through a couple of defenders. He's going to go 61 yards for the score. Gators up 14-0 late first half. Gators looking for more. Chris Leak to Jamel Cornelius. Got him, 48 yards. Florida up by 28 at the half, but back come the Hogs. 23 unanswered points in the second half. Down by 16, it's Matt Jones, who became Arkansas's all-time total offense leader in this game. Finds Marcus Monk for the touchdown. 2-point conversion is good. They cut the lead to 8. Arkansas gets the ball back. Jones, though, picked off by Channing Crowder. And Florida would score on the possession to put Arkansas away. The final 45-30. Leak with a career-high 322 yards. Matt Jones against the all-time Arkansas leader, passing Clint Sterner on the Hogs' all-time list. ACC ball, Wake Forest and NC State. Third quarter, Wolfpack down 14-0. Jay Davis, 57 yards to Sterling Hicks. Look at the patience on Hicks down the sideline. Pauses, and finds his way into the end zone. Nifty footwork for him. Wolfpack up 14-7. Third quarter. Third and 32 for NC State. Davis to Tremaine Hall. Gets the first down. Gets a little more. Led to a T.A. McClendon touchdown run. Ties it up at 14. In the fourth, 21 all. John Duraney, 27 yards. Pushed it. Game tied at 21. We had to overtime. Matt Wisnowski, 35-yard attempt for Wake. Dink. Off the left, upright. Remember, NC State escaped last week against Virginia Tech when the Hokies missed a field goal. They get a chance to win it in their possession in the overtime, and McClendon takes care of it on 3rd and 5 with a 10-yard touchdown run to put it away for NC State. They hang on to win it, 3-1 on the season, 27-21 is the final there. Still waiting on the injured player to get back up in Tuscaloosa. I understand that we're about to resume play. Let's go back to Gary Bender at Alabama.
Matt, thank you very much. We're still waiting on the removal of Keith Brown, who sustained the injury. They're being very cautious. The players have gathered for both teams, praying down on a knee, just broke just a moment ago. And this is the sobering part. There they are. Look, you can see Wesley Britt, number 70, one of the big leaders of this football team, the senior out of McCallum, Alabama. And I tell you guys, we've been around this game a long time, but this always makes it very sobering, yeah, doesn't it?
Puts it in perspective and reminds you that football is the ultimate team sport, and the guys really do love each other, and it's hard to explain if you've never been in that huddle, and that's your brother down on the field, so we just have to hope he's okay.
That's what he is, a brother.
You can turn your master bath into a masterpiece. The Home Depot can...
a right-footed...
Starbucks double shot espresso drink. Bring on the day.
We come back now as Brown has been taken inside, and we'll get an update. We'll let you know as soon as we know what's going on. Alex Flanagan was down there. We understand that Keith Brown's mother was in the near vicinity. This is going to be now a 36-yard field goal attempt.
This is a very difficult angle for a right-footed kicker kicking off the right hash. This is historically the most, I should say, the least frequently made field goal by right-footed kickers. Just because of the difficulty of the angle, they tend to either push it to the right beyond the upright or pull it.
So he's going for the tie here with 25 seconds left in the first half. Bostic earlier able to kick a 29-yarder out of the hole of Alec Fox. Snap was very good. Here's the boot on the way, and the kick is no good. You called it, Bill.
It's just tough.
Let's go down to Alex and see what she knows about Keith Brown.
Well, Gary, we don't know what the injury is yet, but we did see Keith. He was being strapped to the backboard. They didn't take his helmet off. They actually took masking tape and taped his entire helmet and head to the backboard. The good news is that he is conscious. His mother was by his side. He yelled out, "Mama." She told him, "Keith, I'm here, baby. I love you." As he was being taken out of the stands here, the crowd went crazy. He held up his finger.
One time, one out of 13 attempts, and that was South Carolina, one out of seven, Alabama, 0-for-6 on third down conversion attempts.
And Lou Holtz's team throwing for only 37 yards, but you kind of grinned when I said you've seen that before with him.
Well, you said, "Who's ever been ahead with 37 yards?" And I said, Lou Holtz.
So here it all started. Coe Simpson with the interception to start this game. He returned it for 35 yards, setting up a 29-yard field goal. But the thing that's really hurt Alabama is the penalties. Six penalties for 59 yards. On the other hand, South Carolina did not commit one. And then Gillen to Brown. Brown couldn't quite get there, and there's been some real missed opportunities by the Tide. So we're ready to go now as they'll start from the 20-yard line. Gillen giving off to Hudson, and he is shut down. And you guys are saying to me, this is where Lou Holtz loves to get the game. I mean, he's just where he wants to be.
Well, in the first half, Alabama runs the ball better. They pass the ball better. They have more yards in both departments. Yet, Lou Holtz, the turnover down in the red zone. And then Mark Gillen has had trouble. He's been passing the ball well between the 20s. But when he's gotten down in the red zone, he hasn't converted to several open receivers in the end zone.
Loss of a yard, second and 11 now for the Tide. South Carolina trying to win their third straight game. Here's Gillen back. He throws it to Prothro. Prothro up to the 25. Spins his way to the 28-yard line. 2 yards short of the first down. Here's Alex Flanagan. She'll have an update on Keith Brown.
Well, Gary, you remember with 25 seconds left in the first half, Keith Brown tried to make a pass in the end zone. When he hit the wall, kind of the state fence there, and crumpled to the ground, he had limited movement. He was carried off in a stretcher, taken to the hospital. That's all we know about his condition right now. But I did talk to Coach Mike Shula during the half. He said that he was able to grip things with his hand and that he had limited movement in his legs, which is a great sign again. Shula said that he told his team during the half, "Hey, all we can do is hope and pray. We've got to go out now and somebody's got to step up and fill in for Keith."
All right, Alex, very well done. On a third and three, they're very close to the first down. The catch is made by Hudson. Now, where are they going to mark this? They needed to get just about to the 30-yard line. Let's see where they'll spot it. Ricardo Hurley over there to make the tackle.
I don't think they got it.
They're short.
Coming out here in the third quarter, Alabama on offense must get the ball in the hands of Ray Hudson. Must use the weapon that they have in Castile, who's so versatile, and let the big guy McLean be a lead blocker for them.
Noah Whiteside will go back, the sophomore out of Greenville, South Carolina. Freeland with the punt, doesn't turn over, and it's not a good punt. It goes sideways, and I tell you, South Carolina is going to get the ball at the 43-yard line. That's a great way to start your second half.
Well, everything that's going on here is the kind of thing that Lou Holtz really likes. You keep the game close. I mean, even if he were not ahead, you're playing into his hands because he understands the odds and he knows what to do in these situations.
The way you take it out of Lou Holtz's hands, though, is you threaten the field with the pass. And I think Gillen's got to get the ball in the second and third levels of the defense, loosen up a defense that's really coming down hard on the run game and the short passing game.
Well, the statistics in the first half will tell you there was not a lot of offense in this football game. 107 17 yards in total offense. The South Carolina 37 through the air, and the quarterback is going to be Newton. I'm kind of surprised by that because Pinkins had played pretty well in that first half, but Pinkins will start the second half. That was Mark Anderson with a tackle. Here's the stats we were talking about. Third down conversions. Look at that. Combined 1 of 13.
Yeah, look at the penalties for Alabama. 6 for 59 yards, and several of them coming at really critical situations. Not a single penalty called against South Carolina. An extremely disciplined performance so far by the Gamecocks.
Mark Anderson with that play. A loss of 3. The junior out of Tulsa, Oklahoma. Here's a play action. Back to throw now. Here's Pinkins. He gets it off to the near side, and the catch is made by Dacus Terman. He's going to be knocked out of bounds at the 48-yard line as Terman, who broke Herschel Walker's single-season rushing record in high school, made the catch.
That's a nice job coming down to your back. He had Thomas on a post corner route. We look at the comparison. Those are pretty ugly numbers. 3 for 9 in the first half. Get a pass on that last play, but not very attractive play in the passing game by the Gamecocks.
I think you said it well, David. Ugly. Third down and 4. There's Pinkins. He's going to keep it. And I don't know if he got the first down. He needed to get to the 47-yard line. Let's see where they give him his forward progress. That was Roman Harper on the stop. Lou Holtz measuring to see if they got it. They may have to bring the sticks out.
Alabama lined up in a double eagle, or the old Bears defense, if you'll recall, with Buddy Ryan, both at the Chicago Bears and then later with Philadelphia, where he called it the 46, but they put men over the center and both guards. South Carolina called the very best possible audible against the Bears defense, which is the option. The option's a nice answer for that, covering both guards and the center. Let's see if it was successful.
Bill, when they cover both guards in the center, that's awfully tough on a center because he doesn't get any help from the guards.
He doesn't need any help from anybody.
Center's always spoken like a true center.
Center's always the toughest guy.
He's center.
Watch this now. You'll see the natural gap, and we'll stop it if we can. The natural gap in the defense is right here, and that's what Pinkins is going to exploit. And he pops through there. He doesn't pitch the ball because he sees he has enough of an opening in his judgment to make the first, and he was correct by about 2 inches.
First down now for the Gamecocks. They have it at the 47-yard line. 6-3, South Carolina, handoff to Boyd, and he is shut down. Corey Boyd, who was the team's freshman of the year last year, D'Amico Ryans, along with Todd Bates on the stop there for the Tide. It's going to bring up a second down and still 10.
Well, it's very apparent that the Tide is using numbers up on the line of scrimmage. They want to bottle up this run game, and they feel confident that they're not going to be exploited with the passing game. They feel like they can play one-on-one on the outside, and against Williamson, keep a deep cushion against that talented, fast wide receiver on the perimeter.
Williamson has been shut out, which is very unusual. All the passes he's been catching. Here is now Newton giving up and pushing the outside. Nice change of direction that time, and that'll be Boyd picking up 10 yards on the play, and looks like another first down.
Watch Boyd. Watch Corey Boyd run with the football. This tough guy out of New Jersey looks him up in the secondary. He's not trying to make anybody miss. He just punishes Anthony Madison there, lunging forward to make that first down. He's a real football player.
Very productive, isn't he?
Not only a physical runner, but he did a nice job with his agility bouncing it to the outside.
First down now at the 36 of Alabama. Here is Newton on the option. And Newton to the 32-yard line. It'll be Anthony Bryant on the tackle.
Alabama's had success against the option by changing up the option reads and hitting the quarterback in the backfield. South Carolina's a team that runs a little option, so they don't have enough time to rep all the different cross charges. Joe Kynes needs to continue to mix it up so they can't just walk down the field running one option to the left and another to the right.
Lou Holtz mentioned earlier this week that that was one change, that they're going to go with a little more option this year over the 2003 season.
Well, I tell you, the South Carolina team is number one in the SEC in time of possession, and this is a pretty good drive right now. Second and 6. The pitch from Newton. Up it comes to Summers, and Summers is shut down. Boy, that play was really slow developing. Anthony Madison on the tackle.
Well, that's a nice play on the outside by Anthony Madison, recognizing the option and closing in the backfield.
South Carolina with a 6-3 lead. With Bill Curry, David Norrie, and Alex Flanagan, I'm Gary Bender. We're underway, third quarter, 9:21 left to go. It's been a battle of defenses and a field goal. And South Carolina with one of their best drives of the night. Now we'll have the ball at the 35, third down and 9. Back to throw. Chevell Newton, and he has it intercepted. It's picked off by Madison. Anthony Madison, and he comes up with it to the 22-yard line. Madison with his second interception of the season.
Two plays in a row by number 9, Anthony Madison, a brilliant open field tackle on a very poorly executed option play, and then a nice pick where he's sitting in the outside zone, and Savell Newton simply did not see him or thought he could throw it through him.
He tried to throw a bullet, and Madison instead interceded from the 22, first down. Here's Gillen now trying to capitalize. He's got Brotho sprinting out, throws up the field. He throws it right back to the other guy. And here they come. This is going to be Fred Bennett, the number 8, to the other side of the field. And all of a sudden, they give it back, and they have it at the 20-yard line. Wow.
You talk about back-to-back poor throwing decisions. First, Savell Newton loses track of an underneath defender. This time, Gillen's looking for his tight end, and he's got to pick up Bennett there. I mean, Bennett's just sitting underneath and jumping that route by the tight end.
Whoa, did Gillen get lambasted as he's tried to go up to make the play?
Well, oftentimes that's what happens as a quarterback. You make a poor throwing decision, and then you take a pop afterwards.
George
that was
Goss.
A bad decision.
George Goss looked him up. That's what defensive linemen love to do.
From the 20-yard line, and able to wedge it forward is going to be the quarterback, Newton. Let's go back to this last pick that we just had a moment ago.
Well, Savell Newton is looking down the field on a post corner route, and he doesn't keep track of the underneath defender. He was looking to number 1 Noah Whiteside, who was out of the screen to the right. And you have got to pick up on your radar screen all the defenders out in the secondary. You have to feel them, you have to catch them with your vision. Poor decision by Newton.
And then Bennett came back and picked one up for South Carolina. Here is Newton trying to get wide. He's got the corner, and he'll go out of bounds at the 8-yard line. Tracked down on the near side by Charlie Pepperett. Pepperett able to catch up with him. But Newton, I thought, was interesting, guys. When he threw that interception, what Lou Holtz did, he was out there encouraging him.
He really doesn't have much choice. Somebody's got to start encouraging these quarterbacks and not being in their face, because what you don't want them to do is to freeze at the switch. So you put Newton back in the game and you run your option offense. That was supposed to be an off-tackle quarterback single wing, as you called it, David. Single wing play. Bounced outside and got the first down.
I think that's a great thing about Lou Holtz. Sometimes he disciplines you, and other times he knows when to give you a pat on the back.
First and goal now at the 8-yard line. Here's Newton, snap directly back, Newton in, touchdown, South Carolina. Eight-yard touchdown run, 12-3 lead.
Extremely well blocked by number 32, Dacus Terman, on the little fella, DeMarcus Waldrop, number 44. Yeah, here we go. He's going to come with just simply Dacus Terman is going to lead up in here and block on the linebacker. They're going to get the corner because somebody miscontained Mr. Newton, and he just walked in the end zone.
And the point after is good, and so they started playing. Give the ball up, and South Carolina capitalized on an interception, and now lead a 13-3. So Pennington comes in at quarterback, hands off again, and the two handoffs, he gets two first downs. Pennington, a junior out of Fayette, Alabama. He was a backup to Brody Croyle last year. He started one game against Georgia, but was out in the spring because of an injured shoulder, and now with a chance to win this job.
We talked to Mike Shula earlier this week, and he said that Pennington has been throwing the ball very well in practice, and they would not hesitate to go with him, and they would not hesitate to utilize their full package.
First down on two carries. Pennington with his first pass. Throws it near side. It's picked up. Intercepted. And here they go the other way. It's going to be Tremaine Taylor. And he's going to take it to the 10. Knocked out of bounds at the 8. And another interception. So Tyler able to return that one. And that is a return of 40 yards.
This out route was thrown by Pennington about three counts late, working one-on-one outside, and watch the play. Simpson comes downfield, and Tyler, the cornerback, he's reading the quarterback's eyes all the way.
Very good protection. Pennington standing in there, never really sets his feet, David. He does not. He throws a wobbly ball. And it is behind the receiver, and he didn't throw to the outcome.
You talk about throwing with poor timing. That ball came way late.
At the 9, first and goal. Tyler, they call him too tough, and he made too tough a play there. And up the middle goes Newton, and he has scored his second touchdown here of the second half. That's another 8-yard run.
Now, folks, that's just unbelievable. Two consecutive red zone trips for the South Carolina Gamecocks, not known for their power offense, and they walk in the end zone first off the right side with the loss of contain, and second right up the pipe, just knocking the crimson shirts back. I cannot tell you how surprised I am to see that.
I'm surprised to see some of the decisions and the throws that Alabama's making in their own end.
Point after attempt now at the 6:31 mark. This has been a nightmare for Mike Shula and the Tide here in the third quarter. Lou Holtz got to be excited. He's up 20-3, converting two interceptions into 2 8-yard touchdown runs. And the interception by Tyler.
ESPN2's College Football Saturday Primetime. Brought to you by Yamaha, makers of fine motorcycles and ATVs. Nobody's more in tune with motorsports than Yamaha.
We have a stunned Alabama crowd as all of a sudden his team is down 20-3. Pro throw returning the kickoff, a very good return. Gets it out to the 35-yard line. Savelle Newton has two touchdowns here in the third quarter.
This is just an example of big guys getting knocked around. Look at John Strickland, the center, just mauling, blocking back on Rudy Griffin, walking him back so there's about a 6-foot hole. And David Norrie, you could have run through that with ease.
Well, and the Gamecocks pick up an extra blocker every time they run a planned run play with the quarterback. And Pinkins and Newton really starting to find some creases in this defense.
Well, you make a change at quarterback and you suffer the same fate. Boy, I tell you, you talk about bad timing. Pennington's got to come back now after throwing that interception. And they give up straight ahead, and that is going to be Darby, the backup tailback, gets it across the 35 to the 36. I tell you what, Alabama needs some success.
Well, we've raved about the coaching in this game, but Rick Minner, the defensive coordinator for the Gamecocks, deserves a big kudos so far. And they're coming off the edges now. They're coming like gangbusters. Rick knows he's got this Alabama team by the throat because the quarterbacks are going to be gun-shy, and he's going to get after them. You can bet on it.
Coming over from the University of Cincinnati, he is 10 years the head coach of the Bearcats. Second and 9, and Darby bursts up the middle and gets across the 40 to the 43. It'll be about 3 yards short of the first down. Lambert with the tackle, and let's go to Matt.
Gary, number 8, number 9, Auburn and Tennessee, and the Tigers have broken the seal early. Ronnie Brown right up the middle, punishing touchdown run. Balls have tacked on a field goal. It is a 7-3 game in Knoxville.
Tell you what, they've got some 1-2 punch at running back, don't they?
They do indeed.
Third down and three, and I don't need to tell you the Tide needs somehow to convert on this third down. Johnston, the tight end, goes in motion. Pennington to throw. Not well thrown. Poorly thrown, in fact. Tight end Hudson in. This is a very, very unsettled crowd right now.
I think you got to go with Mark Gillen the rest of the way. He made a couple bad plays on interceptions, but I think watching both the quarterbacks on the field of play, he gives them the best chance to win, and you got to get back up on that horse and ride it. They're not going to win this football game. They're not going to come back from 17 points down unless they get the ball down the field in the passing game.
Bo Freeland to punt. He came in second in the SEC. Noah Whiteside is back. Hit it very high. Whiteside drifting over, calls for the fair catch, and we're going to have interference. Made contact as the ball arrived at the 20-yard line. That was a 38-yard punt, a very effective punt. That was Marcel Stamps, who's a true freshman out of Brantley, Alabama, that made the contact.
And Bill, you know what Lou Holtz is thinking. That's 15 yards of field position.
We'll let him make the call here.
Kick catch, interference. Against the kicking team. Penalty's 15 yards from the spot of the foul. Automatic first down.
Well, they're going to get good field position, and that's been the story in the second half for South Carolina.
Previously had been coordinator, then Lou took that over this year, and he says, if this thing's going to fly, I'm going to make it fly myself. There's Skip upstairs. Holt's family, a wonderful family. Beth, mom.
Johnsy Gray is coming in running back. He's got the football, and Gray's going to come across the 35 to the 37. The average starting field position in the 42-yard line area in the second half for South Carolina. That's been big. You can see the play selection. Lou Holtz right now has got this game going the direction he wants.
He does, and the wind has gone out of the sails of the Alabama team. You see a different level of intensity from both squads now. Alabama seemed in control until we got into the third quarter, and now it has flipped.
After the snap, we'll update you on the injury situation on freshman Keith Brown. As Newton gives up and they chuck forward for a couple of yards, we have been told that the x-rays on Keith Brown, and this is very good news, were negative. So that's the most encouraging thing you can hear right now, and boy, we just wish him the very, very best. And you know, you don't know how much that may have taken out of this Alabama team.
No.
Because their wheels have come off right now.
You just stand with one of your teammates down like this, and you watch him hit his face like that, and you wonder what in the world's going on, and it really does affect you, and especially the young players.
He takes football.
So glad he's okay.
You take football so seriously, but it's things like that to remind you it's a game.
Boy, David, we say that, and it's really true. I mean, look at this, a trips formation for Lou Holtz on a third and three to the near side, and then they just have the quarterback try to take it up the middle, so hey, they spread everybody out.
When Lou lines up in trips, that's to get three tacklers away from the running game now without having to block them. That's what trips is to Lou. And he ran the ball, which is exactly what he ought to be doing. He'll punt the ball and play field position now, and he'll do that the rest of the night if necessary. And he won't give up a big play to Alabama if his defense works the way he and Rick Minner would want it to.
So the 67-year-old mentor in his sixth year at South Carolina right now in the driver's seat. And here comes the punt to Brandon Brooks. He fumbled it. The ball is loose at the 15, but Alabama gets it back. Wow. And it just seems like now that Alabama is just fighting to get some points. That's a 44-yard punt. Alabama has the football to 15. Pennington remains in at quarterback. He gives off straight ahead as they just trying to get something put together here offensively. Out to the 20-yard line comes the big fullback, LaRon McClain.
Well, Bill, you know something about the pressure you face as a head coach here at Alabama, and Mike Shula desperately trying to get some play out of Grant and some young quarterbacks. And the interception that Gillen threw in the first half, that's an acceptable play. He didn't pick up Simpson, but the last two interceptions, you know, Mike Shula has to be watching that on the sidelines and saying, I haven't seen that from my kids on the practice field.
No.
Pennington gets off, and Darby is just straightened up and slammed down. A big tackle by Mo Thompson. Oh, what a stop. Let's go to Matt Weiner.
Hi, Gary. Boise State has won 21 straight on their unusual home field. SMU
in Idaho tonight. Jared Zebranski picked off by Alvin Nabufwe. He goes 48 yards. Mustangs up early.
How about SMU? They broke, what, a 15-game losing streak, and now they think they can win some games.
Oh, yeah. They get dangerous.
They pull off that one. Wow.
Four wideouts now. Pennington in a lot of hurt. Ball fumbled. I think Alabama got it. Falling back on the ball very alertly that time was Ray Hudson. As Hurley and Wilson, the two outside linebackers, met at number 13.
All three downs now. Alabama's facing essentially a gap eight. These are two wide tackle six defensive ends coming off the outside. Ricardo Hurley and Rodrique Wilson. Just like the old wide tackle six, and you don't have enough blockers. You can't block them in the run. You can't block them in the throwing game.
So now to punt away will be Freeland. Out of Utah, Alabama doesn't hit it all that well. In fact, it's a very poor punt. Does take an Alabama bounce. Marcel Stamps is down there to ground it. And they're going to have the ball still. Good field position at the Alabama end of the field. A 38-yard punt. So following our game here on ESPN2, the sixth-ranked Ohio State Buckeyes, they just keep finding a way to win, open their Big Ten schedule, as they will take on the Northwestern Wildcats, as Brett Fasanet, the quarterback for Northwestern, will be trying to stand up in that outstanding defense that Ohio State will throw at you. College Football Saturday primetime at 9 Eastern on ESPN2. For more information, log on to ESPN.com. Buckeyes undefeated. Northwestern picking up a victory against Kansas earlier this year. They're 1-3.
If you see another pass from a guy in a white shirt tonight, it's going to be thrown to somebody behind the line of scrimmage.
And I promise you. Lou Holtz will come out and get him by the throat. When they, here comes Newton. Newton up close to the 40-yard line. Thing you're wondering about right now is whether Newton is going to be their starting quarterback. He has really asserted himself here in the third quarter.
He is a playmaker. He doesn't throw as well as Cynical Wallace, but he makes things happen. He has run it in the end zone twice.
Lou Holtz, when he gets in this situation up 17 points, he just squeezes the life out of you with his play calling, working on the clock, and he's doing a pretty good job of it right now.
And he's got it now through three quarters as we come to the end of this third quarter. Very good thought, David. I mean, Lou Holtz, he's looking up and saying, hey, guys, we don't have to get fancy. We're just going to be very conservative and take this baby back to Columbia.
Well, they are knocking them around. Their offensive line's taking over.
So Holtz and company up 20-3. We have 15 minutes left to go. South Carolina with a football, second down, 5 in the third quarter. Alabama had only 21 yards in offense. They just kept throwing the ball to the guys in the wrong jersey. Here's Demetrius Summers, and he skips to the 35-yard line, and boy, he very quickly was able to pick up, it looks like, another first down.
Well, they're sure moving them around up front. The Gamecocks on the offensive front are starting to create some seams.
I'm telling you, I came out here raving about the Alabama offensive line, and I thought they would dominate the game, but it's the guys Jabari Levy, Chris White, John Strickland, Jonathan Alston, and Nashawn Goddard, along with Brian Brownlee, the South Carolina front people, that have taken over this football game.
Well, you know, Lou Holtz told us this week, we got to get better play out of the offensive line. Well, he's gotten that and then some. I mean, that is a big development in this ball game. Here's a handoff again to Summers. Summers going to be shut down at the 32-yard line. Good tackle that time by Pepper. So here is our Yamaha game track. It started with this 35-yard interception by Coach Simpson, the true freshman who has just been sensational and has set up two touchdowns by Seville as Newton takes an end, both of them from 8 yards out as they capitalized on the interceptions and have bumped it up to a 20-3 lead. And right now, they're doing exactly what Lou Holtz wants them to do, keep the football. 13:43 left to go in this one. And here is Newton now keeping, doing nothing in any way that would not be in a conservative event right now. So with 13:30 to go, welcome to Bryant Denny Stadium, a stunned stadium here, a home crowd of Alabama finding their folks down 20-3. Bill Curry David Norrie, Alex Flanagan, Gary Bender. It's been Alabama's ineptness throwing the football, throwing it to South Carolina time and again that has really turned this football game around. Third down and four now for the Gamecocks. Alabama came in here trying to win their fourth straight at home, and they are really going to have to get something going in a hurry.
South Carolina.
And so USC has called timeout, and some of the Alabama faithful have decided they want to do something else. You guys, poundage-wise, but you should be embarrassed. I mean, you have, well, even our cameraman's eating
that. That's Dwayne. Dwayne Krupp will eat a rib in a heartbeat.
All right, well, you should talk. Third down and four now. Here is Newton on the keeper. He's got to get the first down and then some to the 20-yard line. Now, I am very upset because I did get some the other night, but I came up in the booth tonight expecting to get to eat some more. Mm-hmm. You guys had taken all of them. In fact, you ate the first batch. You didn't know they were props for the game. You'd already eaten them.
Gary, you know what we used to do with the big offensive linemen like Bill Curry? We used to double bib them. We'd give them double bibs, a bib in front and a bib in back.
Big offensive lineman like Bill Curry.
What'd you weigh, 240 pounds when you played?
They're so good to make your tongue slap your brains out trying to get at it.
I've heard more expressions from the South this weekend. What's that, butter slipping off of a roll, one that we heard earlier?
If Golic were here, we could describe him as...
Here is Summers. Gets inside the 20.
Golic's butter has done slipped off his
biscuit. Oh, that's what it was. I was close. All right, let's go to Matt Weiner. Matt, you better get us out of trouble.
I don't know if I can match that. I have no ribs. I have merely highlights. Auburn and Tennessee, they swap turnovers in this game in a matter of about a minute, and Auburn benefits. Jason Campbell to Ben Obamato. It's a 14-3 game as the second quarter begins.
Boy, what a big game that is. Auburn and Tennessee down in Neyland Stadium on the Tennessee River. Second down now. 8 yards to go for South Carolina. Fumble by Summers. The ball is loose, and I think Alabama's got it. Todd Bates came up with it, so that gives the Tide hope.
Oh, that gives them plenty of hope here.
That's the one way South Carolina can lose this football game, and Lou Holtz knows it better than anybody in the world. You put it on the ground. Football is a game of ball security,
very sloppy
field position, and physical domination.
Bill, that was sloppy work in the backfield between quarterback and tailback. You've got to secure the football, especially in the red zone. You have a 20-3 lead. He got 3 points for sure. And Lou Holtz, that drives him crazy, those types of errors.
So with 11:40 left, new life now for the Crimson Tide. And the quarterback is still going to be Pennington, being flushed out of the pocket. He's just going to have to throw it away.
David, he's just so hesitant.
Well,
and so hesitant to pull the trigger.
And I really thought that Gillen gave Alabama some real solid play when he was in the game. Granted, the last throw he made was a bad decision. It was an interception. But I thought he gave this team a chance in the passing game. To me, it was a bit of a quick hook, Bill.
You know, David, being a quarterback like you were, when you get a quick hook like that, boy, it takes sometimes a lot of success to ever overcome some of that.
Well, and the interception he threw in the first half, I thought it was not a bad play by him. He had one bad play, and I'm surprised that they're sticking with Pennington here the way that Gillen has played.
He is 0 for 3. You saw that graphic just a moment ago. And there he completes his first pass. Maybe that'll get him started. Ezekiel Knight made the catch, and let's go to Alex.
Hey, Gary. Well, I spoke to Coach Mike Shula during the half, and he seemed to have some concern about his quarterback, Mark Gillen's confidence. He said during the half, he told him, hey, you've got to believe in yourself. I want to remind you guys of a conversation, of our conversation yesterday with offensive coordinator Dave Rader. When I asked him under what circumstances would they play their third-string quarterback, Spencer Pennington, he said, you know, only if Gillen is hurt or can absolutely do nothing with the ball, Pennington not doing much either.
Yeah, you're right, Alex. That completion maybe will get him going now, as it's going to bring up third down and still 6 yards to go after picking up four on the play. Here he is from the shotgun, being flushed out again, resetting, throwing to the near side, and he threw it to the wrong guys again. This is Bennett with his second interception of the night.
Well, I'm speechless. The protection broke down. The young man is clearly overwhelmed. And David, he's just hesitant. I know I'm being repetitive, but he just has a hard time pulling the trigger, and the folks are flat out pouring out of this stadium now. I have never seen this in all the years of being at games here at Alabama as a competitor for or against Alabama.
Well, as a young quarterback, you're in a game, and a meaningful game, a big SEC game like this one. Sometimes you're not able to make sense of things down the field. You don't see things clearly. And as you said, Bill, you're hesitant. But Pennington, I don't think is quite ready. I don't think he got the reps that Gillen got this week, and he's paying for it.
Four interceptions tonight. Well, you saw that look of Mike Shuley. Looked like a deer in headlights. He cannot believe what he's seen. And of course, being a former quarterback for the Tide and a quarterback coach, he's probably searching his brain trying to figure out how to get out of this. Let's go to Matt Weiner.
All right, Gary, let's check in once again on Boise State. Antoine Carter from 2 yards out. The Broncos tied up. They're back on top now, 14-7. Coming up, when you're completed in Tuscaloosa, Brett Basnay, sore shoulder. He's got bigger problems with Ohio State coming up. That's right after you guys.
So we come back. There's Basnay, the Northwestern quarterback. And I tell you what, that Boise State team, Dan Hawkins just does a great job coaching that team. He just reloads. Here now is Boyd. And Boyd spinning forward, picking up pretty good yardage. Corey Boyd able to move it inside the 20-yard line. Now, Brody Croyle is the reason that the Tide had to make a change a week ago, as he had an ACL injury, and he's got Pennington that he's trying to console. I don't even know what you can say to guys right now.
Well, there's not much you can say except just got to get yourself together and go through your progressions. Okay, you read your progressions and make the throw to the open guy, and that sounds so simplistic, but he's just seeing a blur out there right now. That's clear.
Well, I tell you, the people here in Alabama are not used to these kind of football games. You think of all the success they've had, 17 national championships, as Boyd is very close to a first down as he is able to get to the 15-yard line and get stopped there by Chris Harris.
Well, we talked about the fact that South Carolina was lining up in a gap eight. Well, so is Alabama. And they're coming off the corners, and they're hitting every gap, and they're still getting knocked back and being dragged.
This Alabama defense, as an offense, you got to give them a feeling that you're going to be able to move the ball. I think the wind has been totally taken out of Alabama defense in the second half. They don't feel like their offense can move the football.
But you still go out there and tackle a second and one.
They're getting worn down, Bill. They've been out on the field for a long time here in the third and fourth quarters.
Now, remember this. South Carolina has never won here in Tuscaloosa. It's hard to believe, but they're 0-7. There's a handoff to Boyd, shut down this time. Let's look at Lou Holtz. We talked about the old master, what he has done through the years. You can see three wins. He started out losing all these games. Then he put together 17 wins, back-to-back, won two bowl games in 2000 and 2001, and then went 5-7 the last three years.
Yeah, and you know who those bowl games were against. Both of them were Ohio State. One of them a great win when Ohio State made a big run and came back on them. Coach Holtz says this is the kind of game in which he excels.
We have a guy shaking up. It's Jeremy Clark for Alabama, the defensive tackle, who is being assisted off the field, a sophomore who kind of the glue they were telling us about of the defensive line. So Lou Holtz now has a third down and still 3 yards to go. Line of scrimmage, the 17-yard line. Gonzi Gray is the tailback on this particular play. Newton's going to pitch to him, and Gray is going to get the first down. So they'll be inside the 15 as a tackle made by Cornelius Wortham.
Gary, you mentioned at the top, Lou Holtz has taken six teams to bowl games. And what amazes me, each one of those teams, he did it within the first 2 years. And so much history and tradition down here in Tuscaloosa, as Coach Curry knows, who was the coach against Bear Bryant in the Sugar Bowl, the last national title, the seventh that Bear Bryant won? Lou Holtz.
That's right.
Yeah, Coach Bryant told him after the game, that's one of the best games my team has ever played. And Lou said, well, I'm sure glad I got to see it.
They got to be 24-9 in that game as they went 12-0 that year and beat the Razorbacks and Lou Holtz. And here's a handoff, and they just keep pounding away. This is Gonzi Gray. He's the third active winningest coach behind Paterno and Bowden. And He's won a national championship. You mentioned the six different teams, the Bulls. He won a Heisman with Tim Brown when he was coaching at Notre Dame. I mean, he's had some amazing success.
Boy, Bill, and he doesn't back off the accelerator coaching even with the 17-point lead, does he?
No, I think he coaches harder. I'm serious. In these instances, because he knows if he just keeps the hammer down and can keep his team moving like they are, this is going to be his.
Second down and three now. They can get a first and goal just outside the two-yard line. And Newton has done a nice job engineering all this. Very conservative. Gives off Gonzi Gray, and the ball comes out. It's picked up, and running the other way is Rudy Griffin. Griffin, who was a former player at the Citadel. What a big play for him, and that is a return of 23 yards on that play, and Holtz cannot believe it.
I'm going to say this again. The only way South Carolina can lose this football game is if the backs just keep dropping it on the ground. Two series in a row, it looked like they're going to go in and score, and instead they put it on the ground, and they put Alabama right back in it with a chance to get back in this game.
And football, you are always finding ways to come back, and a 17-point lead may look insurmountable. But I'll tell you what, you come out and you put some passes together, you're still in this football game, even with 6:29 to go.
Well, they had a fumble recovery by Bates. They couldn't get anything done. They turned right around and threw the interception. Now they get the fumble recovery by Griffin. Can they do anything with it? A give to Hudson. And Hudson gets across the 30 to the 31-yard line.
That's a strange play call there. That's a play call. And Lou Holtz is fit to be tied on the sideline, I'm telling you.
Well, Lou, one time they put a pedometer on him during a game, and he did something like 6.8 miles or 12 miles. But he is constantly, he gets a great workout during the game. That's why he's so lean.
Next thing you'll do is figure out how many calories he burned up. Gain of four, second and six now. As Pennington will give off again to Hudson. And Hudson, who we figured would be such a big factor, gets some yardage. And let's go now to Matt Weiner.
All right, Gary, San Diego State and UCLA tonight. This is Matt Dugalecki for the Aztecs, and that's not his guy. Spencer Havner will take it 50 yards the other way. And the men in powder blue have taken a 17-3 lead headed to halftime.
Oh, listen, you think David isn't excited? He just saw that return by UCLA. Hold on to him. Here's a handoff to Castile on a third down, and they're not going to get it, and they're now 0 for 11 on third down.
And Gary, three run plays in a row. To me, that's a white flag. I mean, 6:29 to go, and granted, they've had no success, but you're down by 17 points. Anything can happen in a football game. We've seen a lot of stranger things happen. Three straight run calls. I think Mike Shula is saying, I've had enough.
Well, you got three scores to win the football game, and you're running it. You got to go for it here, and you have to make this.
0 for 11 on third down, so they go for it now on fourth and one.
You can't be making any play calls that are going to burn clock, and that's what they're doing.
Double tight ends. Pennington wants to throw. And he threw that ball. A lot of people in the area. There was really nobody open. He tried to hit Clinton Johnston, the tight end, and so South Carolina will take over the football.
Well, it's a terrible feeling for Mike Shula. Every head coach has been through games like this where it just seems like everything that you try to do goes awry. And you've just got a very difficult time to pull your team back together, especially in this situation. And here are some of the mistakes we saw.
Four interceptions. Simpson came up with one. And Bennett. Then it was Tyler. And then eventually Bennett came back and got his second of the ball game.
What's really tough for Mike Shula is I thought that he was getting some very solid play from the quarterback position. And then as the third quarter started to wind down, it just went downhill for him. And I mean it went downhill in a real steep fashion.
Now you can see the combined numbers of Gillen along with Newton. Blake Mitchell now is the quarterback, so the third quarterback of the night for South Carolina. And so Mitchell in. And I want to remind you, stay with us. Ohio State, Northwestern coming up next. There's the guy we just mentioned, Mitchell. And this, I've been in a lot of games and been surprised, but I don't think I've been any more surprised by a football game than I have been tonight. I mean, if this was on the road, that would be one thing. But to come in here like South Carolina has at Bryant Denny Stadium, a place where you just don't win very often, it's been a long night for the Tide.
Well, I have to go back to my scouting report from my old buddy Alex Hawkins, Captain Who from the Baltimore Colts. And he told me after the Vanderbilt game that South Carolina had a terrific offensive line. And after I saw him against Georgia, I did not agree with him. But he was right. And they've come a long way since that Georgia game, especially at the guard position. Chris White and Jonathan Austin have done themselves proud. And so, Hawk, there you go, buddy. You were just a little bit early with your prediction, but these guys have taken charge of this game.
Gary, and you made a great point at breakfast this morning, the couple winnable games here in the upcoming weeks for South Carolina.
Yep, and they'll position themselves very well. They play Ole Miss at home and then go to Kentucky. Again, Ohio State will open their Big Ten schedule against Bazinet and the Northwestern Wildcats. College Football Saturday primetime at 9 Eastern on ESPN to Jim Tressel's Ohio State Buckeyes. They just find ways to win.
Yeah, Jim's got a thing about that, doesn't he? But you know, Alabama's got three timeouts left. They need to be using them right now. They need to be stopping this clock, if for no other reason, to say to the squad, we never give up. We just keep fighting.
Bill, running three times on that last possession, I think they've already said, hey, we're working on next week.
You still got to use every resource.
You know what's amazing, though, as you watch this play again develop up the middle, it's going to be Terman. And they went three straight running plays, then on fourth and one, they tried to throw the ball.
That's very curious play calling. If you're going to throw on fourth down, you might as well be throwing on the prior three downs.
Well, I can tell you from being in this environment particularly, and then in several other environments, that Dave Rader, the offensive coordinator, is going to come under some intense scrutiny about all of those issues, the quarterback play, the quarterback substitutions, and of course the head coach is ultimately responsible. But Dave Rader is going to have some questions to answer as well from this Alabama following.
So the clock now down to 2 minutes. It's going to be third down and three, and they're just keep hammering away. This time it's Corey Boyd right up the middle. There's Dave Rader, who was a head coach at Tulsa for some time. Very articulate guy. Got out of coaching for a while. Came back in, and, you know, I guess the question I have of both of you guys is, how do you rehabilitate the confidence of these two quarterbacks? What are you going to do?
Well, I think that Pennington's going to need some real work on the practice field. He made some plays out here that really I think Mike Shula hasn't seen from him on a practice field. And I still think that Gillen has some confidence and some talent level to finish off the SEC season.
Look at South Carolina here, Bill, going for it.
This is the right call. It's the right call to go for it, even if they hadn't made it. You leave Alabama on their 18. Let's say you get stoned. So Alabama starts on their 18. What, you think they're going to make three scoring drives? Not a chance. So you run the ball because you've been knocking them in the dirt anyhow, and you go ahead and make the first down, and now if Coach Holtz wants to, he can take a knee and run this clock out.
Yeah, he can. Holtz will win his 31st game at South Carolina against 33 losses. He was lauded as the savior of South Carolina football. He had that winless first season, came back in 2000 and 2001, most successful two-year run in Gamecock history, and then has had a tough time getting it back around, but this may be his return to a very successful season. As they're going to go to an E now, with the clock running.
But we asked him about that, Gary, and he said this generation of young people just requires more perseverance. You have to stay next to them. You have to remind them constantly. They had the best grade point average last spring in the history of Carolina football, 2.59 cumulative. So they started doing everything right. He said the first person that had to change was me. I had to get back into the details.
And you look back on the Georgia game, they led that game 16-0. This team could easily be undefeated going into next week.
Yeah. Kurt McCallie in charge of the stats. Ken Trevor, our stage manager. Kim Anderson, our spotter. Josh Hopman, our producer. And John McDonough, our director. Thanks, guys. It's a very surprising end to this. As now, let's go to Alex with Coach Lou Holtz.
Let's turn Coach Holtz around here. Coach, this is the first time that this team has won at Tuscaloosa. How different was this game from what you expected it to be?
Well, I didn't expect to fumble inside the 15 so many times. It was a great effort by our defense. Offensively, we made some adjustments, came out to run the football, had some success, got good field position. We just wanted to win and get out of here.
You continued rotating the quarterbacks. What do you do going forward?
Well, we went with Seville the second half. half because Dondrell hurt his shoulder. Then Savelle tweaked his ankle a little bit, so thank goodness we had three.
What's the biggest thing you learned about your team tonight?
We'll compete. We'll make mistakes, but we'll compete. They're a wonderful group, and God's blessed us.
All right, Coach, thank you very much.
Thank you.
Well, very, very successful. I feel bad for this guy, Brody Croyle, who, of course, could not play. But Lou Holtz, very, very interesting win. 20-3 the final. South Carolina 20, Alabama 3. Coming up next on ESPN2, Ohio State versus Northwestern. For a wrap of this game, catches on ESPN News in just a few minutes. This has been a presentation of ESPN, the worldwide leader in sports.